Israel is, by many measures, the country relative to its population that's done the most to contribute to the technology revolution.
Now, when you look at the NASDAQ, companies are listed from around the world. There's one country, though, that truly stands out, and that is Israel.
If you go to the Middle East looking for oil, you don't need to stop in Israel. But if you go looking for brains, for energy, for integrity, you know, it's the only stop you need to make in the Middle East.
For over 60 years, Israel has been at war, the target of terrorist attacks, and boycotted by many of her neighbors. Yet somehow, during this same time, she has built a nation, transformed an arid wasteland into an agricultural miracle, and evolved into one of the most technologically innovative countries in the world. How did a nation of 7 million manage this transformation? Mayor Brand runs Google's Israel operation.
The foundation of Israel itself could be seen as an entrepreneurial project. The pioneers who came to build Israel from scratch, they are real entrepreneurs. They took a huge risk. They came to a place that doesn't have much natural resources, that there are a lot of threats from the outside, but they still had a great vision in building a successful country, which means that from the foundation of this country, people were already experienced in risk-taking.
As president of one of Israel's premier science research institutions, Daniel Zajman thinks part of the explanation is deeply embedded in Jewish culture.
We are allowed to ask questions. We are allowed to discuss it. This is very unique, in fact, in the Jewish religion.
A willingness to challenge conventional wisdom distinguishes Israel's approach to science.
For many scientists, what is on the paper and has been published must be the truth. For an Israeli scientist, what has been published is something that might still question and maybe push further.
Israel has this intense penchant for constantly questioning and debating and challenging, which is essential for any innovation-based economy.
Dan Senor is co-author of Startup Nation, Israel's Economic Miracle.
Some of the factors that have been key to Israel's economic success, the role of the military. Almost every single Israeli goes through a leadership experience at a very young age. They're taught at age 18, 19, 20 years old what it means to lead, what it means to improvise, what it means to be entrepreneurial, albeit out in the battlefield. Civilian R&D spending. Israel spends the highest percentage of its economy compared to any country in the world on R&D. Israel has cutting-edge policies on immigration and assimilation. There are over 70 nationalities represented in Israel.
The rapid integration of these immigrants through an aggressive Hebrew language immersion program has ensured they participate in Israel's innovation.
If you look at the Soviet wave of immigration, 750,000, tens of thousands of those had these remarkable degrees in mathematics, in science. It was just this huge influx of technological talent.
This talent has fueled more startups than anywhere outside the Silicon Valley, bringing the world's leading corporations to Israel for their top R&D talent. And this economic engine has in turn strengthened the young nation.
If you describe Zionism as having a prosperous, strong Jewish state in Israel, obviously the high-tech sector goes hand in hand with that.
But Israel isn't just innovating for its own ends.
A lot of the innovation that comes out from Israel changes the lives of people all over the world.
I think that the time where we could export oranges is basically gone, because if you really look at what we can do here and what we can export, then it's basically knowledge.
Whether it's in irrigation and saving water, smart use of energy, space investigation, nanotechnology, green technology.
The world has a lot to learn from Israel, especially at a time when there is so much yearning for an innovation-based economic strategy.
For me, Zionism is not only about the prosperity of Jewish people in Israel, but also Jewish people bringing more prosperity to the world.
Well, how amazing is that?
Yes, Henry. I think it picks up on where we were before as well, about risk-taking and the sorts of life skills. Israelis are risk-takers. And if you look at the innovations that have come through, they've been established because young people have been taught to take risks. Most people would not be aware of some of the innovations that come out of Israel. And our telephone technology, the Intel chip, just about everybody's computer is powered by the Intel chip.
USB sticks.
And the fact that we take our telephones and we SMS, the SMS technology, that platform out of Israel. Israel, this tiny little state, smaller than Tasmania, it is the third largest stock traded on the NASDAQ outside of US, which is obviously the NASDAQ is US. Secondly, you're looking at China and the growth in China, and then there is this tiny little state called Israel. And not only are you looking at technology is such a big thing, but we are looking at things like agriculture and water and health and sciences. These things are all being created because Israelis don't know how to say no. They're being taught at schools through science to question, to say there's got to be a better way of doing things. And that's the sort of thing that we need to learn from other countries. Here in Australia, we import from Israel about 2.5 times more than we export. And the reason why we do that is because we are being able to learn from so many of these fantastic technology companies.
And there is a lot of cross-pollination, isn't there, between Israel and Australia now?
There is. In fact, the Victorian government have an agreement with Israel called VizTech, and I'm supporting that for the government at the moment. And that's looking at biotech, it's looking at innovation, it's looking at science and how we can together look at ways of being able to create new opportunities. And we can learn so much from Israel. One of the things that a lot of people don't understand is you look at even the military. Young people in Israel at the very early age are identified as potential, and they are taken their support, and everybody has to do military service. Mm. But as part of that, if you are actually in this elite group, IBM and all the big
companies get headhunted
yep. out of that group, mm-hmm. and effectively they're supported all the way through. So they harness young people, and they harness intelligence, and they take that and they commercialize it. And that's why they've been so successful. And with everything else going on around them, Israelis focus on the real game, and the real game is success. The real game is to continue to grow and to support one another. And that's what's really exciting for me, because with all of the problems, this little state continues, apart from everything else, to be successful.
And everybody in Israel really is a boat person, except for the people who've been there for generations. But we're just going to go into the next part of the show, and that's we're all boat people. And everybody that came to Israel in the last 60-odd years has come from all over the world and conglomerated into an amazing state that is now leading the world in so many fields.
Yeah, that's right. 70 different nationalities actually are in Israel, and many of those people that we're referring to are actually, again, supported and harnessed, and their skills are developed, which I'm excited to talk about that next.
Okay.
Good.
We're going to go to a break now. We'll be back with the opening of a new exhibition at the Jewish Museum of Australia called Calling Australia Home. And we'll talk to David about immigration and refugees and all kinds of wonderful things.
Thanks, Henry.
We'll be back after the break.